Thank you. Good morning, Triangle Grace Church, and those who are watching in many places this morning. Trust that you've taken a moment to quiet your hearts for worship as you've been listening to the music. As we begin worship this morning, just a few quick announcements for you. We know that now North's not open up, according to our governor, until the 8th of May. And in Durham, I think we've heard that it's the 15th of May. We plan to continue with these Facebook Live worship services into the future so you can continue to come here on Sunday mornings for worship at 10 o'clock. We are using new equipment, and we're changing things every week in order to learn and understand about this. And so we just pray that you would be in prayer that all things would work out, but also just have a measure of patience as we continue to work through the various things that need to be worked through as we continue to figure out new equipment and make this the best possible worship experience that you might have wherever you are this morning. This week, I spoke with Pastor Julio from Iglesia Emmanuel Church across town. They came and picked up some more food even this morning. They said their numbers have swelled in each week, and they started with about 60 families. They're now ministering to about 250 families. So we are going to continue to keep our front door open so that you can come and drop off food. You'll see the three carts parked in the narthex, and you don't have to talk with anyone or speak with, you can just bring your stuff in, drop it right there, and we'll make sure it gets to Iglesia Emmanuel. If you would like to make monetary donations, we're still receiving those. You've been very generous in all of this. This morning, it took them two cars to get what was here, and they had already come from another load earlier in the week, so you're doing a great job. Keep it up. You're doing kingdom business as you go and shop or else make donations so that others are able to have food to eat during this very difficult time. As we begin our worship this morning, I was drawn to Paul's letter to the Christians at Philippi. Many of you perhaps have been relying on that little book because it's full of joy. I mentioned it in one of the emails this week concerning Paul was, in a sense, in social distancing when he wrote these. He was in prison. We're not exactly sure what that was like. It could have been a house arrest, but whatever it meant, he could not get out and do the things that he wanted to do. And yet, he says in the midst of that, his desire is to learn to be content in the Lord. And so hopefully we're learning some of that contentedness as well. These words written from prison by the Apostle Paul, let's hear them as we begin our worship. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say it, rejoice. The end is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Finally, he says, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you've learned and received or heard from me or seen in me, he says, put it in practice, and the God of peace will be with you. What wonderful advice for Paul to us in this strange day, that we would think on these things, those things that are noble and kind and just. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we are grateful for the opportunity that we have to worship you this day. And our desire is to lift high the name of Jesus, the one who came and lived and died and rose again, our Savior, the one who offers us life abundant and life eternal. And our desire this morning is from the very places we are to offer you worship that you may be glorified in our hearts and through our lives. So be with us in the midst of this time, wherever we are, and give us the sure sense of your presence. And Lord, we will give you all honor and praise and glory this day and every day. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Our opening hymn this morning is for our young disciples. Although you older disciples may be surprised that the song Jesus Loves Me has more than one verse to it. So we're going to sing all three of those verses. This is also being sung by all of us this morning in honor of a very special friend. Whether you're at home, wherever you may be, if you can, why don't you stand up? You can always sing better when you're standing. And let's sing together in Jesus Loves Me.
Let us join together saying the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It's important for us to understand that we are family. So I want to speak right now to the disciples, to the children of our church, and those who might be visiting online. God is good and faithful. God is powerful. I brought with me something. I don't know if you can see it. I brought a small keychain. It's in the shape of a fish. This summer, the high school kids and I went to camp, and they gave everyone this small fish. And this fish reminds me. I hope it reminds you of the story that we know so well. that Jesus took just 5 loaves and 2 fish, and he prayed to God, his Father, and he multiplied the fish and bread, and he fed more than 5,000 people. That's the gift that we have from God. And that we have stories like that all over the Bible, where Jesus provides more than we ever can imagine. Later, we'll be reading a story from the book of Revelation. In that book, we will also see where God multiplies his blessing, where he gives us more than what we expected. So Jesus is with you. He knows you. He loves you. And you can call on him by name, and he will bless you. Amen.
And this morning, it's time for us to turn to the Lord in prayer, knowing that he hears and answers our prayers. I wish that we could be together so that you could raise your hand and I could call on you and ask for your particular prayer concerns. But know that even though we're not able to do that right now, that God is hearing your prayers, wherever they are, wherever you're praying them from. Together, let's, as a congregational family, lift our hearts before the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we come to you this morning with grateful hearts because of your goodness, because of your grace. Apart from the redemption that we have in Jesus, we would dare not seek to come to your presence. But because of his sacrifice for us on the cross, we're able to come to you, calling you Father. What a gift that is, that we come not as aliens, not as strangers, but as your very children. We know that you love us, as you have demonstrated that love by own Son. We recognize our need for your love. We know that there is no true life apart from you, and it is in you that we who we are and why we are. We're living in a strange time, Father. It's a disruptive time. For many, it's a fearful time, a hurt time. We know that our time and this time is in your hands. As hard it is as it is for us to understand, we trust you're working things out according to your ultimate plan. And that plan is to redeem creation. And so, give us to trust in you. Give us hearts that are able to put our faith in your goodness. We pray that in these days of social distancing that you would teach judgment. Open our eyes to see the wonder and beauty that is around us during this season of the year. Give us a renewed sense of appreciation for the relationships that we enjoy with family and with friends. Oh, how we look forward to those days when we're able to gather once again, not just as a congregational family, but as neighbors and friends in our homes. Help us to see the ways that we can out to others who are hurting in this time, even if it is only through a phone call or a note or an email. Place those people on our hearts that you would intend for us to be a conduit of your love and mercy and grace. Give each one of us a sure sense of your presence wherever we are, and help us also to be comforted with the knowledge that we're all here in your presence. And we're connected by your love, even though distant from one another. And now, although separated from one another physically, we still voice the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed would be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We've been blessed Sundays when we've not been able to have anyone with us to have certain members of our congregation come in and share some special music. We're grateful to Caitlin Saunders for being with us this morning to share her message in song.
You take what is and you make it beautiful. When love floods in, we're restored forevermore. With breath that brings the dead to life, with words that pierce the dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. With mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree, you alone hold the power to redeem. No guilt competes with innocence crucified. No grave can hold what your grace has justified. With breath that brings the dead to life, with words that pierce dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. The mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree, you alone hold the power to redeem. Rejoice, O child of God. Lift your eyes to see. With every morning light, again we are redeemed. Rejoice, O child of God. Lift your eyes to see. With every morning light, again we are redeemed. Oh, with breath that brings the dead to life, with words that pierce the dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. With mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree, you alone hold the power to redeem. Oh, you alone hold the power to redeem. Oh, you alone hold the power to redeem.
Thank you, Caitlin, for leading us in worship with song. That was beautiful. Our scripture this morning is from the book of Revelation. We will look at the first chapter, and we will start with verses 10 and go through verse 20. Revelation chapter 1, verses 10 through 20. Our sermon this morning is entitled Forever, A to Z. Much of this sermon is influenced by the book Disciples Edge, which was written by one of the professors in seminary, Daryl Johnson. You know, Star Wars is a fictitious movie about an epic intergalactic battle between good and evil. Luke Skywalker versus the dark Darth Vader. In 1977, when my family arrived at the movie theater to watch the original Star Wars, Dad, as a young boy, and I said, Dad, I lost my courage. I lost my courage to see this movie. My dad assured me that it'd be okay, that he was with me. In the book of Revelation, we see another, a real epic battle. Good and evil. God versus the dragon. Holiness versus sin. As we read the Bible today, let us not lose our courage. Let us be confident that God, Heavenly Father, He is always with us. As we approach the scripture this morning, let us pray once again. Lord Jesus, we glorify you alone, our Savior and our King. Thank you for the truth of Christmas and Easter. We thank you that you are faithful and you are with us always. Bless us this day that we may grow in our understanding of your love, presence, and power. We praise you, Lord Jesus. You are the light of the world. Amen. From Revelation chapter 1, starting with verse 10. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice, like a trumpet, saying, write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergam, and to Thyatira, and to Sardis, and to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white, like white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze, refined in a furnace, and his voice was like a roar of many waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not. I am the first and the last and the living one. I died. And behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, the things that you have seen, those that are to take place after this. As far as the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. A theme in Revelation is things are not as they seem. We are all right now very aware of the epic battle that we are fighting against this virus. We are concerned for our health, our finances, and what tomorrow might bring. It is easy for us to have fears, and to even have doubts, wondering, where are you, Lord? What's going on? The truth is, God has not. God is good. God is present. God is powerful. Two times in Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 9, we see the truth emphasized that Jesus is the eternal Lord. Verse 4, Scripture tells us, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. In verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 10, we learn that while John praying, he heard a loud voice like a trumpet from behind him. Can you picture this? John is on an island by himself, Patmos, and he's praying. And as he's listening to God, he hears a voice like a loud trumpet behind him. Verse 11 continues that the loud voice behind him said, Write what you see, and then send it to the seven churches. Then John turned. Scripture tells us, on turning to see the sound that was behind him, he saw. What we know is that John heard, he turned, and he saw. This was not something in his head. This was an experience. This really happened. And then Scripture tells us in verse 12, on turning, this is what he saw. He saw seven golden lampstands. At the end of our scripture, in verse 20, it defines the seven golden lampstands are the seven churches. What did lampstands do? Lampstands support the light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Now, these seven churches are the light of the world because they're holding up, they're supporting the light that is in Jesus. In verse 13, we see a very specific title for Jesus, Son of Man. This title comes from the Old Testament, the book of Daniel, chapter 7. There it tells us, there came one like a son of man. Dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away. See, the one that John was praying to, he turned and he saw, is this one, the Son of Man, whose authority and power is everlasting. Let me ask you a question. If I were to ask you, what does a doctor wear? You might explain a doctor wears scrubs or maybe a white jacket with a stethoscope around their neck. If I were to ask you, what does a cowboy wear? You might say boots or a cowboy hat. Just as our clothes may tell us something about who we are, in Revelation chapter 1, 13 through 18, John notices the specific characteristics about the Son of Man that gives us more information about who he is. The first thing that John noticed when he turned and saw the Son of Man is that he was wearing a long robe and that he had a golden sash across his chest. The only one who wore such a robe, such a long specific robe, was the high priest. Last Sunday, we had a very special time after the church service. I've been teaching confirmation class since mid-February, and the confirmation class was able to join the church meeting with the session on last week. It was a very special time. I want to invite you to pray for these kids and to celebrate with them how God is working in their lives. The students who were there last week, Landon, Alex, Jake, Ethan, Parker, Isabel, Megan, and Bailey. During our class, while we were still preparing for them to join the church, I asked them this question. I said, draw for me a picture of the Grand Canyon. We had some very interesting pictures of the Grand Canyon. I instructed the youth, now that you have the Grand Canyon, draw me on one side of the canyon. We had a lot of laughs about their draw me. On the other side of the Grand Canyon, we put God. Chasm, a large canyon separates us from God. I added that there's some lava that we could not cross through the cabin. You try to jump over, you can't jump over. You can't crawl through because of the lava. There's nothing we can do on ourselves to get to the other side of the canyon where God is. But Jesus. Jesus is able to build a bridge that is shaped like a cross. Because the Son of Man is wearing a long robe in Revelation 1:13, that tells us he is the high priest. The high priest is the perfect bridge builder. He knows both sides of the canyon, and he crosses the divide to bring us to the other side, to take us to our to take us to our true Heavenly Father. I want to invite you to imagine a construction worker. He or she, they wear their tool belt around their hips, don't they? They do that so that they can work, and as they're working, they can bring out their hammer or their treasure. In Revelation 1:19, Scripture tells us that the Son of Man was wearing a golden sash across his chest. To wear a golden sash across your chest and not at your hips indicates that he's finished working. The Son of Man, Jesus, has finished working. And this is only chapter 1 of Revelation. The first thing that John notices about the king, about the sash is across his chest. His work is done. What about the epic battle? The battle with the dragon? The work has already been complete. On the cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." And then he rose on the third day, just as he said that he would. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the one who is, the one who was, the one who is to come, the Almighty. He already finished his work and has victory even before the battle begins. It is finished. He is risen indeed. We all know that fishing stories tend to have a reputation they're exaggerated. I promise this fish story is not exaggerated. When a young boy, my family went to the Pamlico for vacation. One day we went fishing in our boat and we came across a school of bluefish and they were biting. In just a few minutes, we caught over 16 bluefish. The fishing frenzy was so great, I accidentally dropped a line in the water, did not have any bait on it, and I caught a fish. The Bible tells us that one night the disciples were fishing in a boat, but they did not catch anything. He said, "Cast your net on the other side." They caught so many fish that their nets were full. This was a sign that in Jesus there is abundance. He provides and gives more than we could ever imagine. Jesus does not exaggerate when he says, "I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Jesus is revealing his power and his abundance, Revelation 1, 16 through 18. The Bible tells us in verse 16 that in his right hand he held 7 stars. We know from the bottom of verse 20 that the 7 stars are the angels of the 7 churches. Have you noticed in this passage there are a lot of 7s here? The number 7 in Revelation means all, complete, full. Jesus is holding all of the churches in his right hand. In the first century, there were 7 known planets in the universe. Scripture is telling us Jesus is not just holding the whole world in his hands. He has the whole universe in his right hand. And the scripture continues in verse 17. What does he do with his right hand? John said, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead, but he placed his right hand on me." With the same hand that is holding all of the churches and the entire universe, he reaches down and he touches John. By touching John with his right hand, the Son of Man is communicating, "I have you also." With his right hand touching John, then we hear his voice, the word of the Lord, saying, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, and see, I live forever and ever. I hold the keys of death and Hades." Jesus, while touching John, while holding the stars, while holding the universe, says, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last, the living one. I am not dead. I am alive forever and ever." In Revelation 1, There are seven characteristics revealed about the Son of Man. As we said, seven means complete. The Son of Man, Jesus, is being revealed for the very first time in Revelation as being complete. But there's more. Revelation 1, there are three sets of the number seven. There are seven churches, seven stars, and seven characteristics of the Son of Man. In Revelation, the number three means complete. Seven means complete. 777, Jesus is revealing that this is his number, and that means complete, complete. He is fully complete, lacking nothing, and he loves us abundantly. This is why Jesus is wearing the golden sash across his chest. Jesus is fully victorious. We have real victory in him alone. In this world, we know there's chaos. We're very aware of that. Maybe right now we feel kind of stuck on the wrong side of the Grand Canyon. Do you feel like it's distant? That this virus is too big, that the financial crisis is too great. Jesus, the Son of Man, is Lord. He is the complete, complete, perfect bridge builder. He is the one and only Savior who reaches over to us and touches us with his right hand. With the same hand that he holds up all the churches and all the stars, the entire universe, he also holds you and me. He lifts us out of death into eternal life with God the Father. He is the Alpha, the Omega, the one who is, the one who was, the one who is to come, the Almighty, forever, from A to Z. Jesus the Messiah. He shall reign forever and ever. King of kings, Lord of lords. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us continue to worship our Lord this morning. I want to invite you to lift up your voices as we sing this well-known hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Thank you. We have a true King that is with us. He's always been with us. Jesus, the Son of Man, is the one who is now, the one that was, the one who will be. He is always with us. He's very near. He tells us to have courage because he holds the stars in his hand, the church is in his hand, the whole universe is in his right hand, and we are in his hand. Jesus, the Lord, he's with us. He's before us. He's behind us. He's to our left and to our right. He knows us by name. He loves us. Praise be to God. Amen. Thank you.